Hello, this is Kathy Vandiver. I'm glad you're able to join us today, and I'm going to begin with a little bit of background about the two centers I work for. I work for the MIT Center for the Environmental Health Sciences and also the MIT Edgerton Center. Just as a quick note, MIT has about 30 to 40 outreach programs. The MIT Edgerton Center hosts about 3,000 students per year on half-day field trips on the MIT campus. And I'm providing this website in case you'd like to look at some other programs that we offer. The website will be updated as of the end of August, so I provided both views for you here. We have curriculum packages also posted online with teacher guides and student materials, and these are at a website called Mind in Hand, the motto of MIT, and also showing these two screen views. And this down here, the Atoms and Molecules set, is the one I will be talking further about today. Just as a point, at the Edgerton Center, we focus on key concepts that teachers find difficult to teach. And one of them is the atomic nature of matter, which now actually has been suggested as one of the six cross-cutting concepts in the next generation standards. As a middle school teacher, I know that you'll recognize these topics here. We teach a lot of introductory work in chemistry about chemical reactions, also introduce them when we talk about photosynthesis. And then when we're talking about air and weather, there are lots of things that have to do with molecules that need to be explained. So this is why we focus on the atomic nature of matter, because we teach across all these subjects. I'd just like to point out that the Edgerton Center and the Center for Environmental Health Sciences has shared these packages and lessons at the Massachusetts Association of Science Teachers workshops, also at the Summer Institute in Texas, which we just came back from shortly, and also in Maine more recently, too. Okay, so how do most middle schoolers identify a chemical reaction? Here's a picture from the Edgerton Center, and the students are looking at a chemical reaction that's happening inside this bag. And it's extremely interesting. It's changing temperature, color, the bag is blowing up. And in a few moments, they will be really more than fascinated. So students in the beginning first see that chemicals are reacting in a chemical reaction. And also, they associate chemical reactions with explosions, fizzing, color changes, you know it. So actually, chemical reactions occur inside of you and all around you, not just with lab chemicals. And so many times, students are unable to apply this chemistry concept into other contexts, such as biology and earth science. And a lot more study has been done on that, so I just provided a reference below. In chemical reactions, the real point of the whole process is to teach that atoms get rearranged into different molecules with different properties, and that's their definition. But molecules and atoms are hard to visualize for students. One way in which we can talk about the new products is actually by showing them. This is what we do at the Edgerton Center. In this particular lesson, we have calcium chloride in the bag as well as baking soda. And what's really interesting is we show the products, which include the gas that came off as CO2, this precipitant here as chalk. You can see that the students here have tested out the chalk, and here it is provided here. It was a new product. And we can also identify by its new properties this NaCl, which now we can crystallize. So identifying the products is one of the things you can do. However, I think one of the really strong suits of the lesson now is that we visualize the atoms in the reaction by using these inviting Lego bricks. Each brick represents an atom. And as you can see, these colors down the side are the standard CPK chemistry colors. And down here we have shown how these atoms can be snapped together as bonded atoms would be in a molecule, so CO2, water, and nitrogen as particular shapes. So it's very nice. The students can actually build those reactant molecules in their standard shapes, and they place them on this mat, And when they're built right, they fit just perfectly. So the students get that feedback of building them correctly. And then we can show with one flip of the map, students get to take the same atoms, they had the same bricks, and rearrange them into being these new products. And therefore, they get the reinforcement from doing it, from seeing it and actually doing it, that they make carbon dioxide, chalk, water, an extra molecule of water, and sodium chloride. This is really fun. I want to let you know that I've taught this lesson, first of all, by using bricks to teach about photosynthesis. And I typically have one or two kids in sixth grade that would literally pop out of their seats because they'd be so excited. They would yell, "I get it." And it was just so much fun as a teacher. So I just like to point out what makes it a lot more fun also to teach about matter, atoms, elements, these definitions that one needs to be really clear about. You can do them by using these models. And this I'm showing on the screen is a graphic organizer that can be used for class notes. The red is actually teacher instructions. This is the key. And the blue is answers. I also like to mention that the kit management is really simple. Kids work in teams of two, and they place their mats. This is the mat, sorry. They place their bricks on top of them in little stacks. They don't have to count them, and they really enjoy this very much. So you can see that these bricks as atoms could be modeled, could be used as models for chemical reactions at many different times during middle school. And we have these lessons. So I've talked about the chemistry, chemical reactions one. We also use it in photosynthesis, where you can model the reaction of six water, six carbon dioxide, making a big, wonderful glucose molecule and having six oxygens left over. But it happens that students can also take away, you know, they have to learn about parts of the cell. Well, at this point, if they have to learn about the functions, it's really nice to be able to have them understand what a chloroplast is doing because they understand now the process. But also, you can demystify mitochondria because you can show cellular respiration, which is the reaction going the other direction and liberating energy. But right now, we're going to focus on the main point of this talk, which is really using these models to teach about air. And air is a mixture, which is really nice. It gives a nice example of mixtures. Our first lesson, understanding air, we begin by raising curiosity about what is in air. And these are samples that I chose from my own students' misunderstandings and display them here. It's quite easy even for younger kids to look at the circle and see that this one is mostly nitrogen. This one down here, this option would be a lot of carbon dioxide and oxygen, and this one would be mostly oxygen. I used to survey my class by having them put their heads down on the desk, and then I would say how many people like option A, and then they would raise their hand, and B and C, so the voting would be really very personal, and you didn't have to worry about kids looking at what other kids were answering. So you get a very good understanding of preconceptions before starting. So the answer was really a surprise to many kids, and this is a model that is a mat that we use for putting our Legos on. So you can see that 8 out of the 10 molecules here would be nitrogen, 80%, 20% oxygen. But what's really interesting is noticing that less than 1% is CO2, which is really an important point for kids when they're hearing so much about CO2. Also, at this point, we could move to looking at the fact that we are looking at carbon dioxide at so such low levels, we probably need to use a different measurement system. So we use parts per million, and I can show you how this can relate to a lot of math that might be done at this age. So I really like to be able to use math in science class, and so down at the bottom of the screen, you can see how you can work with equivalent fractions, and your math teachers would be really delighted. But moving back now to looking at the numbers, parts per million, when this mat was produced, this CO2 level was 390 parts per million, 390. Safe CO2 levels have been established internationally as being 350 parts per million. And if you go online right now You're welcome, Sue. It turns out that the current parts per million for CO2, are you ready to guess? It's 399 parts per million. So I think it's really a good point to be able to acquaint kids with these numbers and get a chance to see it, what amounts of carbon dioxide are in the air and how we measure them. So this Understanding Air lesson has class notes. This slide here shows them, and this slide shows a teacher's guide, which has been put on the class notes. The red are hints and suggestions, and the blue are keys or answers. Oh, I just wanted to pause for a moment. I put this slide in because I didn't want to get too carried away with classroom work, and I wanted to point out that these Lego activities are great standalone ones. And so we show you samples from Science Family Days at the Boston Conference in this February. And you can see graduate students and undergraduates participating. And this is what the kit looks like. It's a small kit here, and the mats are here in front. We also have used these in other events, for instance, at the Cambridge Science Festival, which we do every year in partnership with the Harvard School of Public Health. And this event, the last few years, has been held in the Cambridge Public Library. And then also these events work very well with just community areas. So this one was done, that I have a picture of down here, is from a clean air fair, also with Harvard School of Public Health. So Legos are particularly inviting. You can just see how I've just made a quick comparison here. They're familiar, exciting, and inspire confidence in students in approaching them. All right, so here is the lesson that we would be doing particularly to introduce why carbon dioxide levels are increasing. So right here we have a mat, and we're going to start with the hydrocarbon. We've chosen propane as a simple one. Most kids are familiar with it from barbecue days. And we're going to burn it with oxygen here. And actually, I have learned recently that there are more vehicles on the road that are using propane. So what happens is we get the spark, which ends up creating the starting off the chemical reaction. When you flip the mat over and you use exactly the same atoms, you just rearrange them, start with water, and then kids start to see that they're producing a lot of CO2 molecules. And this brings up the opportunity to talk about CO2 as a greenhouse gas. This lesson, which includes short media clips as well, have been put together by WGBH and are now organized on PBS Learning Media. And so there are short videos that are 3 minutes long or so that explain more about greenhouse gases, if you'd like to have that done, and also provide some documents, famous documents, such as the CO2 recordings from the Mauna Loa Observatory. It's just a wonderful collection. I just put this in here because I realized it was a fun use math and science, particularly for the older kids, to look at the graph and just see this is CO2 levels and how much they're going up, but how someone could make an argument if only using these points on the curve over five-year time to say, oh, look, the CO2 is not increasing. So these graphs and other information, I think, have a wealth of detail that you could use in many different ways. Now we're moving to the lesson two in Understanding Air, where we're going to focus a bit more on air pollution itself. And kids can see how this happens if you start with propane again, build your propane molecule, lay it on the mat, put the four oxygen molecules on the mat, and then react them. If you take your atoms and put them together, you'll first produce water, and then you have a choice here. You can choose this box. Some teams in the room might do this one, and other teams might do this one. you'll notice that this one not only is producing carbon dioxide, but also soot. Carbon might be stuck together. And down here you have, in the lower box, you have the products including carbon monoxide. So this is quite a good time to talk about things that are bad for your health. And most kids, when they're faced with looking at soot and carbon monoxide and a deep breath over here, I'm sure that they will provide you with lots of information about what's bad for your health. This mat is not a chemical reactions mat. It's actually just a straight layout mat, which introduces a lot of new molecules. And so I'm going to just flip to the next one. This is the answer key. Or you could use this side of the mat for younger aged kids because it provides the colors and they don't have to look at the formulas to figure them out. So right now, this is wonderful. You can really help a lot of people who still have problems and trying to understand about ozone, that ozone can be this ozone layer up high that's protective and good for us, and yet we do have ozone being produced down here on the ground, and that is a really important opportunity. You can explain that. And also it introduces the molecules of sulfur dioxide, and you can see that they are spouting out here from this coal-fired plant. A lot of nice opportunity to talk about that after it's been built. And also introducing NO2 as well. This mat was made for more advanced children, as you can see, and advanced adults, of course. So here we are. We can actually take our atoms and molecules made from Lego and demonstrate any of these reactions. And these are not step-by-step guided. They're just available for students to look at and to learn more from. These lesson plans, I'd like to point out, jive very nicely with the air quality index. That's one of the reasons why I chose and got excited about making these lesson plans, because I saw that the weather information was providing information on them, particularly about ozone levels, particle pollution, carbon dioxide, and sulfur dioxide. So this is really an interactive. It's very nice. I'm sorry I can't illustrate it better here, but you can roll over these and see side effects. You can choose the level and see what here of, let's say, a particle pollution and see which people would be affected the most. So it's really a very nice summary. Lesson plans also include media clips. This one I wanted to point out to you is an environmental justice topic. It's really wonderful. It's about this teen who lives in Mill Village, and she mapped the contaminants from a coal-fired electrical plant and onto Google, and was able to make more people aware of what was going on. And I just checked it out recently and discovered that there is a story about these plants closing early. So I was really pleased to learn about that. We did some evaluations, and I'd like to provide you with these results. The evaluations were done on both classroom and informal settings on the air pollution and air climate change lessons, which together we call understanding air. So the method was by using a Likert scale here and testing, asking for the scale was 1 to 4, and we were looking at responses that had to do with enjoyment, reported self-learning, and increased interest. So the younger kids just happened to be a little bit younger age, as you can see, and they really were superbly delighted about working with Legos to understand these concepts and asked a lot of questions. It wasn't just Lego building. And they also wanted to learn more. I'll show you on the next couple of slides what they said they learned from the activity. We also did this lesson in Revere, Massachusetts with 137 students, eighth graders this time, and they also were very positive and also interested in learning more. So the open response questions, I would like to point out, I was really pleased that health was mentioned as one thing they learned, and molecules in air and combustion pulled also very high in both responses. It was great to see them write out things that they had learned. So this was really a very rewarding evaluation to do. This is my summary of the concepts. I think we could call them learning goals for these lessons on understanding air. And I thought I'd just make sure to put them in this presentation so you could see them. Lastly, here are my credits, and I've got plenty. This has been wonderful to be working at different parts of different teams. And the atmospheric science advisors at MIT were extremely helpful to us. This is our production team from our two centers. I also just put up the Mind and Hand website again in case you wanted to write that down and have it. And then lastly, I would like to provide special thanks to the team at WGBH who decided that this to do something besides media clips and include these Lego plans, which really was fun to do, and also to NIEHS, who has provided the backing and the funding for this collection. So I'd like to mention this lesson on understanding air is just part of a very large collection of lessons, and you can find them now on Learning Media, Environmental Public Health. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Kathy. If you have any questions for Kathy, please use the GoToWebinar questions panel at this time. While we're waiting, I have one here. Kathy, what motivated or inspired you to shift gears and go back to school to get your Master's of Education and teach?
You know, it's always a small story, and so I'll tell this little story. I volunteered. I volunteered in my son's fourth grade class, and I taught a lesson about cells and the immune system. And I had puppets and all sorts of things, and I got such rave reviews from everybody. I suddenly turned my head and said, this was really, really rewarding. So that made me decide that I would go back to school. So I found that there was a good program at the Harvard School of Education, graduate school, and they had a group of other scientists there that were attending too. So it made a very congenial group, and I enjoyed that process very much too.
Okay. Could you share a little bit more about the PBS website?
Oh, I'd love to, yes. So NIEHS actually funded a project where WGBH in Boston, they produced NOVA. They went and found a lot of pertinent clips that had to do with environmental health issues. For instance, I can remember very vividly, they have footage of kids eating sandwiches being sprayed with DDT to show how safe it was. So there are all these things you can see about how our views have changed over time, but they're part of they're short clips. They're like 3 to 5 minutes long, and you can put them in various places, and I think they add so much. And then they do have a complete lesson plan, if you'd like them, on various topics. And I personally learned a lot of my own, broadened my own view about environmental health by being a reviewer on these lessons. So I recommend them highly.
Great. Thank you, Kathy. We really appreciate that. We can hear your enthusiasm and doing outreach and education, and we appreciate the efforts and all of your success and the work that you've done over the years.